Chapter 1 of Fact Stranger Than Fiction, Fact Stranger Than Fiction by John Patterson Green. Origin of the Family Green, The Short and Simple Annals of the Poor. John P. Green, the subject of this sketch, was born in the old town of New Bern, North Carolina, on the second day of April, 1845. His parents were John R. Green and Temperance Green, both of whom were free colored people of mixed blood and highly respected by the people of both races in that community. John R. Green, the father, was the reputed son of John Stanley, spelled by him Stanly, of North Carolina, who was the son of John Wright Stanley of the same place, and who, during our Revolutionary War, for a long period of time maintained a fleet of 14 privateers in the vicinity of the West India Islands, which preyed upon British commerce quite successfully until, being attacked in its West Indian harbor of refuge by a portion of the British Navy, it was thoroughly destroyed, and Stanley betook himself to commerce and merchandise in the old North Carolina town, at that time the capital of the state. This is the same John Wright Stanley upon whose head, with that of William Gaston, a great revolutionary patriot of the same state and community, was placed a premium by the British military authorities during that war, and who, in the darkest days of the War of Independence, loaned General Nathaniel Green the sum of £40,000, which I may say was never repaid to him. And when we consider the scarcity of money at that time, and that £40,000 was as valuable then as £200,000 is now, we can form a correct estimate of the patriotism of that son of the Revolution. It may interest the reader in passing to know that Gaston was murdered by British spies for the bounty which was offered for his head, but Stanley lived to see the end of the war and enjoy the blessings of liberty for many years under our glorious stars and stripes. John Stanley, my reputed grandfather, was widely noted for his legal lore and successful practice at the bar of North Carolina. It was said of him that he never lost a case, but as to the truthfulness of this statement I am somewhat incredulous, unless it be a fact that he had very few cases, or that he was so uniformly successful in practice that it became a proverb that he lost no cases. That he was a great orator, politician, and statesman was well known. He was, for 7 consecutive sessions of the North Carolina House of Representatives, Speaker of the House, was in Congress once, and followed and sustained that great party of which Henry Clay was the famous leader, known as the Whig Party, and stood for America for Americans and the protection of American industries. This John Stanley, in the early part of the last century, became involved in a quarrel with Governor Richard Dobbs Spite of North Carolina, one of the original signers of our national constitution, and accepting a challenge sent to him by Governor Spite, they fought a duel in which the governor was killed. This was a social and political calamity in the old North State, for a long time deplored, and did much to bring into hatred, scorn, and contempt a system of so-called honor which was finally outlawed under a heavy penalty. Herein, peculiarly enough, lies the explanation of this writer's name being John Green rather than John Stanley. My father's mother, Sarah Rice, a woman of African descent, had for years been a good and faithful maid servant in the home of the unfortunate Governor Spite, and had exercised over the little girls and maidens of that august southern family almost maternal care, a condition of affairs which I suspect few persons in the Northeast and West can adequately conceive of, unless they lived in the South during the slavery era and became familiar with it, so close was the association between the Negro and mulatto nurses and their little wards that even down to the present day we often hear the signs of old Southern families and some of the elderly ladies from the same section refer to their old black mammies with accents of love and affection. Such was the love and affection for Sarah Rice on the part of the Spite family that they set her free, manumitted, emancipated her, giving her at the same time the sum of $200 as required by the law of the state at that time. Previous to this important event in the life of this favored nurse, she had been delivered of a wee boy baby whom she had named for herself only, Johnny Rice, not daring to disclose his true paternity, but subsequently having attained her freedom, she called him Johnny Green, for a little boy whom she had nursed, for Johnny, having been born when his mother was still in the bonds of slavery, followed his mother's slave condition, and not having been manumitted with her, he was still the slave of the Spite estate, and to let it be known that he was the natural son of John Stanley, the fatal ball from whose pistol had killed the governor would in all probability have sealed his fate adversely. So Johnny Green became in later days John R. Rice Green, and this writer, his son, has flaunted the green flag as John P. Patterson Green ever since, sometimes really, fact is stranger than fiction, having stated it as a matter of fact that my father, John R. Green, was the reputed son of John Stanley, a son of the Revolution. The skeptical may demand the proof of this fact. If so, I submit the following data. A. Sarah Rice, John R. Green's mother, declared that Stanley was his father. B. John Stanley, on his dying bed, sent for my father, and to him in person acknowledged his paternity, giving him at the same time a steel engraved likeness of himself, which we still have in our family. C. My father, it was generally conceded, bore a more striking resemblance to Stanley than any other of his sons, except that he was a shade darker. D. It was common rumor in that community that Stanley was his father. To the best of my knowledge, the most illustrious son of my grandfather, John Stanley, was the Honorable Edward Stanley, M.C., who was leader of the Whig Party in Congress in the 40s. This gentleman and scholar was later on the first nominee of the Republican Party for governor of California, and afterwards, during the Reconstruction period subsequent to our Civil War, was appointed by President Andrew Johnson provisional governor of North Carolina. I've gone into this matter somewhat minutely because I am proud of the fact that I can trace my descent from a family so distinguished in both camp and state, and also because it furnishes to the student of society and social standards in these United States a concrete example of how fearfully and wonderfully a large percentage of the colored people here are made. I shall end any further consideration of the Stanley family by submitting the following epitaph from the pen of the late William Gaston of North Carolina, who was the son of that William Gaston, the friend and associate of John Wright Stanley, who died a martyr in the cause of American liberty. This William Gaston, who wrote the epitaph, was noted in his day and down to the present as having been one of nature's noblemen and the greatest Chief Justice and jurist his state ever produced. He was from the first John Stanley's close personal friend, both at the bar and in the political arena, and well knew whereof he spoke. The following is the epitaph: John Stanley, eldest son of John Wright Stanley and Anne, his wife, born 1774, died August 2nd, 1833. Few persons in any community have occupied a more prominent station. Few have exercised a more powerful influence than this distinguished individual for many years held and exercised in our town and throughout our state. Long in the affectionate and grateful remembrance of all will live his genius, his learning, his courtesy, his eloquence, his virtues, his personal characteristics, and his public services. Gaston. My mother, Mrs. Temperance Durden Green, was a quadroon by blood and was a direct descendant on both her father's and her mother's side from those Scottish and Yorkshire Englishmen who followed the flag and fortunes of the last pretender, descendant of the unfortunate James II of England in 1745, and after having met disastrous defeat at Derby, almost at the gates of London, were expatriated and in large numbers found asylum in North Carolina, notably in the counties of Cumberland and Sampson, where by thrift and economy they left a numerous and wealthy progeny, as may be seen by tourists and others today. In the latter part of the 18th century, 1792, to be specific, there resided near the town of Clinton in Sampson County, North Carolina, about 30 miles from the city, then town of Fayetteville, in the same state, a family containing two beautiful daughters, of which a man, Chestnut, or Chestnut with two T's by name, was the head. This paterfamilias was a well-to-do farmer, and with his wife and daughters was known and respected far and wide by persons of his class. Moreover, since his daughters were young and comely, they were frequently favored by the calls of young gentlemen in the vicinage who socially and financially deemed themselves their superiors. In the course of time, the young ladies became greatly enamored of two of these young men, but since they did not hasten to make to them proposals of marriage, they had recourse to the advice and services of a likely young colored man, the slave of their father, who advised them in the premises, with the result that ere long each became the mother of a little colored girl. One of these baby girls was named Obedience, which was transformed to Bede. This one was my grandmother, born in the same year as my father, 1793. The child of the other girl, sister of this first mother, was named Alice, but invariably, as long as she lived, called A. Lice. A glance will suggest that these two babies, being the offspring of one father by two sisters, were at once sisters and cousins. This condition during the womanhood of these two colored girls was doubly complicated when each girl presented to two white brothers severally a child, one of whom was my mother. If the foregoing is proof of a low moral status amongst both white and colored persons in that portion of these United States, at that time, place of the podium, where it belongs, not at the door of the poor slaves, nor should we forget that as far back as the time of Homer, when bondsmen were of every nationality and race, it became a maxim that Jove made it certain that whatever day makes man a slave takes half his worth away. Moreover, it seems to be a natural inclination governing dominant and oppressing men to take unjust advantages of unprotected females and others, as witness the Romans under Romulus taking by force the Sabine virgins and carrying them into captivity, and a more recent proof of my contention may be found in the conduct of the German warriors and the Reds of Russia, who have disregarded every sacred right of conjugal, maternal, and virginal purity. Under such conditions, those damnable doctrines, might makes right, and to the victor belong the spoils, are an unspeakable curse. It may interest the reader to know that both those colored girls lived to a ripe old age. Bede, my grandmother, lived to be nearly 97 years of age, and had she not yielded to dread pneumonia, she would probably have rounded out a century. Alice was almost 90 years of age when she died. Both left behind them a numerous progeny, thus proving the fallacy of that scientific dogma that mulattoes cannot reproduce their species, for both were mulattoes, having white mothers and a negro father. Granny Bede was in her youth and young womanhood a very strong and active woman, as the two anecdotes which follow concerning her will abundantly prove. When she was between 18 and 20 years of age, she had to some extent the care of the cows and other cattle belonging to the farm on which she was reared. On one occasion it became necessary to put a rope around the horns of a powerful steer which was confined in the pen, but this being at a time remotely anterior to the herding of cattle on our western prairies and skilful lassoing of the same by our doughty cowboys, the men failed of success, and after repeated efforts and failures appealed to Bede, their keeper. "Here's Bede," they said, "they know her, let her try." No sooner said than done, for in a jiffy she vaulted over the fence of the pen, and noose in hand, dauntlessly approached, confronted the steer, lowering his head. The beast rushed at her. In this supreme moment, Granny did not scream and faint, but grasping his horn, she held his nose to the ground until relieved, when she triumphantly climbed back over the fence, the cynosure of all eyes, the heroine of the moment, and even down to the present day in the estimation of this writer and others. The other incident follows. In 1872, when she was in the 79th year of her age, I visited her on a farm in the suburbs of Bennettsville, Marlborough County, South Carolina. The little cabin in which she then resided was on the roadside at the edge of a 50-acre cotton field, and it becoming necessary to call one of the hands to his dinner, she did not ring a bell or sound a horn, but with a stentorian voice called, "Lewis, oh, Lewis!" I can hear her to this day. "Come to dinner." Needless to say, Lewis heard the gladsome summons, and dropping his hoe in his tracks, ran as the crow flies to that refreshment which his manly labor entitled him to, and which made a mere dish of corned beef, and more palatable to him than any nectar brewed by a fabled god. My dear mother was a born Spartan, with not the slightest suspicion of African blood traceable in features or complexion, with brown eyes, auburn hair, high cheek bones, high forehead, straight nose, and thin compressed lips. She was a study for everyone who was introduced to her as a colored woman, and yet she married a colored man, not disowning her descent, and to her death in her 81st year of age, she commingled with her colored friends. Some conception of my mother's energy and determined spirit may be gained from the fact that when she was about 20 years of age, she walked from Clinton, Sampson County, North Carolina, to Fayetteville, North Carolina, in less than one day, arriving in Fayetteville in a foundered condition, carrying her shoes in her hand. When she arrived in Cleveland, she had occasion to transact some business with Mr. Blair, who owned the extensive real estate on the south side of Prospect Street, just east of 30th Street. Mr. Blair said to her, "Of what nationality are you?" Mother answered, "I am a colored woman." "Well," replied Mr. Blair, "I wouldn't tell it." Mother could wash and iron, cook, make any article of wearing apparel for either man or woman, from a shirt to a Prince Albert coat. In addition to all this, she had been taught and thoroughly understood how to card wool or cotton, spin with the wheel and weave at the loom. She could gather the cotton from the stalk in the field with her own hands, without assistance, card, spin, weave, and manufacture it into a suit of clothes. She could even knit the stockings of the family. The first kite ever flown by me was attached to a ball of twine which my mother had manufactured for me out of the raw cotton. When she, a comely lass of 24 summers, married my father in 1837, he took her to a beautiful home, which was still standing in 1897, when I last visited old Newbern Town, and was in use as a parsonage for the Presbyterian pastor and his family. The interior decorations of this house by the carpenter in the 30s cost in cash $1,800, an amount which would purchase then what $5,000 would today. Having given a survey of the Stanley family and others of his ancestors, I will now proceed to give an outline of my father's brief but useful and remarkable life. And here and now, I dare assert that, taking into consideration the time and place of his birth, his enslaved condition, his absolute handicap in the way of obtaining even the rudiments of an education, his was one of the most remarkable careers that stand attested by any other colored man of his age and generation. It is a peculiar and interesting fact, which I may mention in passing, that my father and I together have lived in portions of three centuries, the 18th, the 19th, and the 20th centuries. Father was born, as I have said, in the year 1793. He lived until November 1850, while this writer, having been born in 1845, in the 19th century, is still living in the 20th century. In addition to the foregoing, it may be noted that we each have lived in two centuries, my father in the 18th and 19th century, and this writer in the 19th and 20th centuries. My father, having been born of a slave mother before she was manumitted, his estate followed that of his unfortunate mother. He was a slave. Ye gods, fancy the son of a Stanley in slavery. Yet stranger conditions than this have existed in the southern states of this country. The natural colored sons and daughters of many slave masters have been openly sold on the auction block, and the proceeds of those sales have gone to line the pockets of their unnatural parents. Little Johnny Green was of such small and delicate frame, even up to the time when he entered his teens, that it was somewhat of a problem what disposition should be made of him. A laborious occupation for him was out of the question, and as for a professional career, that was not to be thought of. Finally, it was determined to apprentice him to a tailor, and the resolution was no sooner adopted than executed. At the age of 13 in 1806, when by reason of diminutive size he was dubbed Jack the Weasel, he first crossed his legs on the board and commenced a career which continued for 43 years, when death ended it. Father related many instances of shameful treatment of him by some of the apprentice boys during his apprenticeship, who frequently picked on him, but to his last day he spoke in terms of superlative gratitude of the protection often extended to him by a Frenchman, du Rond by name, whose memory I laud and magnify to this day. Who can tell the limitation of little deeds of kindness, little words of love? He also often spoke of his meager supply of food when old Aunt Hannah, his caretaker, would at times prepare and serve him kush, a dish which I suspect few of the present generation know anything about. Having been served with the same dish in my childhood, I hereby submit that recipe for making that inexpensive and palatable dish. Take crusts and crumbs of cold cornbread, moisten them moderately, put them into a spider frying pan containing a modicum of hot grease, and let them fry until all are nicely browned. Then voila, a dish for a hungry boy. We think we are experiencing hard times in our day, and we are in many instances, but what will you say when I avow to you that the mistress of his salve cousin Maria, often before sending her out into the street to perform an errand, would grease her lips in token of the fact that she had been eating meat? Father considering his direct lineal descent was in reason, necessarily an apt pupil, and in the course of a year or two he began to earn money by doing extra work during his spare hours and by occupying some of the hours allotted to him for sleep in this way. At the age of 21, when his apprenticeship was ended, he was the proud possessor of $1,000, which he ultimately used in buying his freedom, for he related that after he had married a free wife, he could no longer endure the yoke of slavery. When he attained his liberty, he had already learned to read and write. In fact, he had to some extent mastered the three R's. No school door swung open or even ajar for him. He learned the alphabet in some mysterious way, for it was a crime to teach a slave to read and write. In this respect, he was in a sadder plight than the great Frederick Douglass, for he, before he escaped from slavery, had some side instruction, but father had no instructor, save a copy of the then Webster's Elementary Spelling Book, which was his inseparable companion by night and by day. And with the assistance of a blind man, whom at times he led through the street, he was gradually inducted into the mystery of reading. The method in practice between my daddy and the blind man was as follows. Dad would call the letters of a word, and the blind man would tell him how to pronounce it, and Jack the Weasel, like his forebears, being naturally clever, ere long was reading in the same little book the monosyllabic sentences beginning, "No man may put off the law of God." It may surprise the reader to learn that in after years, without any additional schooling, my father kept the single and double entry books of accounts used in his business, that at the time of his death he owned a large collection of books, amongst which I can at this late day recall the Life and Speeches of Henry Clay, the Church Register, which contained thorough accounts of nationwide transactions in the Protestant Episcopal Church of the United States, A History of the World by Sir Walter Raleigh, Rollins' Ancient History, and many others. In fact, so choice and in some instances rare was his collection of books that when, by order of my mother, they were sold at public auction, the bidding was spirited and the competition noteworthy to obtain possession of some of them, even amongst the wealthy slaveholders who were in attendance. Unquestionably, my father possessed a great desire for literary attainments and did his utmost to reach to some excellence along that line. This talent on his part was recognized during all his life. Men of learning and discrimination sought him in his store and engaged him in conversation to such an extent that much of his valuable time was lost in this way, and even the bishops of the Episcopal Church, of which he was a member, Bishops Ives and Atkinson respectively, always visited and conversed with him when they made their Episcopal visits to Old Christ Church in that town. In this connection, it may not be amiss to state that although born and reared a slave and residing in a slaveholding community, my daddy so deported himself as to merit and receive kind and courteous treatment from all. He owned and occupied with his family a pew in Christ Episcopal Church, which was the most wealthy and aristocratic congregation in that part of the state, while the other members, with two exceptions, sat in the galleries, and as proving how tenacious he was of what he conceived to be his rights, it may be stated that when the Reverend Dr. Buxton White, a clergyman of the Episcopal Church, married him and my mother in Fayetteville, North Carolina, in 1837, and did not wear his clerical robe, he would not give him a bill which he carried in his vest pocket for him. I may add in passing that my father, who never aspired to be called a poet in any sense, yet undoubtedly was possessed of the afflatus to some extent, for he read the higher poets with avidity and had committed many excerpts to memory, which in animated conversation he often repeated. As an illustration, I will here record one which I have carried in my memory for 65 years, and during that time I have never seen it in print. Where are those names which set the world on fire? Where does the pride of Rome and Greece retire? Caesar's dread name now marks the butcher's dog, while Cato saws wood and Scipio drives the hog. Seek ye for Pompey, search the tanner's yard, while Nero you'll find your kitchen's faithful guard. As tending to show that father was possessed of a keen sense of humor and could on occasion extemporize a little rhyme, I will give the following illustration. One Sunday afternoon, when he and some of his boon companions were promenading one of the principal streets of the town, he noticed that one of them, Boston by name, was wearing a coat which had been made in his tailor's shop, and that it had been dyed black. Like a flash, he slapped Boston on his shoulder and exclaimed, "This coat I know it once was brown, and shone all o'er this new-burned town. But now, alas, this coat is black, and shines upon poor Boston's back." It is needless to remark that this thrust drew forth much merriment at the expense of poor Boston, but since it was confined to the friendly group, it was taken for a joke as was intended. The following epitaph, written composed by my father, was engraved on the marble headstone placed by him at the head of his first wife's grave, in grateful and loving remembrance of her. She died beloved and even revered by the whole community in which she was born, and passed her useful and devout life. Sacred to the memory of Sally Green, who departed this life, March 29, 1837, aged 45 years, 6 months, a constant friend, a tender, loving wife, prudent in all the needful cares of life, and when arrested by the hand of death, in faith and hope resigned her mortal breath. Her soul, we trust, doth dwell with God above, and there drinks on the copious streams of love. In the course of father's long experience as a tailor and merchant tailor, he had many apprentices, some of whom became quite noteworthy by reason of their attainments and mercantile successes. The most conspicuous of these was the late Reverend William J. Austin, a native of Raleigh, North Carolina, who for 8 years was under my father's eye and finished his apprenticeship cum magna lata. William, as he was called, was for years bubbling over with animal spirits. He was rude, boisterous, and untidy, and more than once had to be disciplined. It was the general opinion of William that he was a ne'er-do-well, and that he would come to no good end. On one occasion he tied up his small wardrobe in a bandana handkerchief and shipped to sail before the mast. However, he was intercepted by my father before the departure of the schooner, taken with his luggage back to his home, soundly flogged, and given some wholesome advice for his government in the future. Shortly thereafter he was invited to participate in the exercises of a singing society which held Sunday afternoon sessions. He accepted the invitation, became a regular and most interested member, and ultimately announced his intention to study theology for the Episcopal ministry. This resolution having been received with marked favor by his father, the late Oscar Austin of Raleigh, North Carolina, he was in a way matriculated in an institution at Chapel Hill, North Carolina, where he was prepared for college. After that, he was graduated from Oberlin College in the later 50s, and finally at Cambier, Ohio, became a full-fledged priest in the Episcopal Church. In many years, this true and tried servant of God, as rector of both St. Philip's Church, New York City, and St. Thomas Church, Philadelphia, preached Jesus Christ and Him crucified, and his sweet exemplary life was as a beacon light to many who perhaps otherwise would have been stranded and lost. The following anecdote related by Reverend Austin to my dear mother in my presence goes far to prove the almost intolerable condition which prevailed even in religious educational institutions in the United States prior to the Civil War. Being the only colored student in Kenyon College prior to the abolition of slavery, Austin was the cynosure of all eyes, and at times not a little at a loss for companionship and even association. To such an extent was this true that on one occasion, while taking a stroll in the suburbs of the old college town, he was confronted by a cow, who, honoring him with a friendly stare, turned out of his way, gave him gangway, as the vulgar expression of our day would have it. Delighted at the unusual recognition and courtesy shown him by the humble brute, Austin saluted her and exclaimed, "Good morning, Mrs. Cow." It goes without saying that we had a hearty laugh over the incident. Another story related by him at the same time is recalled by the former. During a summer vacation, while exerting himself to add to the contents of his meager purse, he shipped as a waiter on a steamer plying between Cleveland and Lake Superior ports. On arriving at Duluth, Escanaba, or some one of the other seaport towns, he left the steamer and went in search of some other remunerative employment. The older readers of this narrative will recall that during the later part of the 50s, the whole country was in the grip of a most trying panic, which made it almost impossible to procure remunerative labor at any price. William, in that remote section, soon made this discovery, and since the boat had gone and funds were extremely low, he was open to any job that presented itself. He soon found it in the shape of a small mountain of earth which had been formed by the excavation of a large hole to be used as a cellar. The owner of this mountain offered to pay him the sum of $35 and furnish him with a shovel and wheelbarrow if he would remove it. In a jiffy he accepted the proposition, and without delay, having peeled off his coat, disregarding his flaccid muscles and tender hands, he bent to his task. At the end of 2 weeks he had finished the undertaking and received his compensation, which he had in his pocket when the boat returned to convey him back to Cleveland. Another father's apprentice, who was graduated with honor from his workshop, was the late Jerry Harvey of Boston, Massachusetts. Mr. Harvey, near the close of his apprenticeship, had the sad misfortune, while playfully pointing a gun at a comrade on Christmas Day, to kill him by its accidental discharge. In North Carolina in the 30s, such an occurrence was an exceedingly grave affair, for the old criminal common law of England, with only slight modification, was still in vogue, which made the condition of the offender vastly different than now under our enlightened and merciful regime. However, my father went to the front for him, and as usual he received a respectful hearing in behalf of the unfortunate young man, and the matter was compromised by allowing the defendant to leave the state, not to return again. Without any delay, Mr. Harvey betook himself to Boston, where he followed the trade which had been taught him, and being very successful along this line, his name became well known, especially amongst colored people in all sections of New England. At that period in the history of the South, Mr. Harvey might with propriety have paraphrased our well-known school declamation beginning, "Banished from Rome, New Bern, what's banished but set free from daily contact with the things I loathe." My father was a man of generous impulses. He really, at times when pressed to bestow a favor, could not say no. And since the homestead exemptions to heads of families in that state at that time were extremely scant, the usual result followed. He was compelled to meet the defaults of others by exhausting his earnings and sacrificing his properties. Added to this was the fact that on two several occasions his establishments were destroyed by fire. On both occasions he was the victim of neighboring conflagrations. It is scarcely necessary to say that the amount of insurance recovered by him at that time was of slight value, hence his was an almost total loss. Twice he bought some of his relatives when being sold at public auction, being entreated by them to save them from the speculator. Note, the speculator was a person who traveled from one location to another, buying slaves for resale and speculation in the cotton, cane, and rice-producing sections of the Gulf States. The amounts thus advanced by him, it is needless to say, were never returned to him. Being importuned by two frail mulatto youths, apprentices of his, for whom he entertained regard and sympathy, he bought them on their promise to repay him the money advanced in installments. Sad to relate, both these young men died of tuberculosis before they had paid to him a tenth of the money advanced, $1,000 for each of them. Here again was an additional loss of $2,000, which we must not forget was then worth at least three times as much as at the present time. Ultimately, of course, he was stripped of all his earthly possessions save his honor, and broken in body, bereft of his redundant humor, good cheer, and genial, whole-souled, winsome conversation, he betook himself to his bed, from which he was never to rise again. The sheriff came, levied on everything, save the sad and downcast widow and three forlorn children, ranging in age from 11 years to 9 months. This writer, being second in order, was 5 years of age, small and weak for the age. "Lift me up and let me die," he said to our dear mother, after a lingering illness, and so died John R. Green of New Bern, North Carolina, of whom it may be said he loved not wisely but too well. The more I reflect on the current of my father's eventful life, of his early struggles for existence, his social limitations, his vaulting ambitions, his consuming zeal, and his unspeakable disappointments, the more I wonder at the phenomenal successes which attended his efforts. He was broad and cosmopolitan in his views, and although he was a colored American in a slave state, carrying on his shoulders all that incubus of caste proscription which characterized the time and place in which he lived, yet he counted amongst his friends and quasi-associates many of the wealthy as well as the poor whites in the place of his residence. It was no uncommon occurrence to meet in his place of business illiterate persons of the white race, who took advantage of his literary attainments to procure begging petitions and other documents for public use. And after his death I was accosted frequently by persons of both races, who would ask me, "Whose boy are you?" I would answer, "I'm the son of John R. Green." Then invariably the reply would be, "Well, son, you must be a good boy, for your father was a good man." Father was very fond of aquatic sports. If a vessel was to be launched or any race rowed on the river, he was sure to be one of the spectators, and as for swimming, boating, and fishing, they were the acme of his out-of-door pleasures. The town of New Bern, North Carolina is located in the triangle formed by the juncture of the Neuse and Trent rivers, where they unite to form Pamlico Sound. These rivers, as well as the Sound, are well stocked with many species of most delicious seafood, not omitting oysters, clams, and hard and soft shell crabs. So fond was he of seafood that when the hegira of colored people from the south to the north was at flood tide during the decade prior to the Civil War, and especially during the debates in Congress about the year 1850, and he was asked whether or not he intended to join in the procession, he answered that he would never leave North Carolina until he could carry the Neuse and Trent rivers with him. And it is a notable fact that as long as we remained in that state, he was the only person who knowingly had ever walked over the frozen surface of the Trent River at New Bern, where it is from a half to a mile wide. This feat he daringly accomplished during the winter of 1833-4, as my mother informed me. As a workman, my father was without a superior in that section of the state. He designed and executed all styles of clothing and uniforms which the trade demanded, even going back to old continental styles and theatrical costumes. In closing this brief sketch of the life of my dear father, I shall use the lines of Lord Byron as dedicated to a poetic enthusiast of his time, White by name, only paraphrasing the word or two to make them applicable. Unhappy soul, when life was in its spring, and thy young muse just waved her joyous wing, the spoiler swept thy soaring lyre away, which else had sounded an immortal lay. Oh, what a noble life was there undone, when science's self destroyed her favourite son. Yes, she too much indulged thy fond pursuit, she sowed the seed, but death has reaped the fruit. 'Twas thine own genius struck the fatal blow, and helped to plant the wound that laid thee low. Like the struck eagle stretched upon the plain, no more through rolling clouds to soar again, viewed his own feather on the fatal dart, and winged the shaft that quivered in his heart. Keen were his pangs, yet keener far to feel, he nursed the pinion which impelled the steel, while the same plumage which had warmed his nest drank the last life-drop of his bleeding breast. Here begins in an humble way an epic to end when and how God in his great wisdom, power, and mercy wills it to end. We follow the little somber hearse by twos in the direction of Christ Church Cemetery, now popularly known there as Rock Cemetery. Mother supported on the arm of a true and tried old friend, leading the cortege, this writer clinging to the arm of his elder sister, next, a few friends following. The beautiful burial services of the Episcopal Church having been read, and the final earth-to-earth, dust-to-dust having been pronounced forlorn and needy, we turn away to confront and fight, to strut and fret, our more or less gloomy way, widowed and fatherless for many years to come. Mother, glum, demure, and determined as ever a Spartan mother showed herself, turns from her palatial residence of yore, mahogany furniture, cut glass, silver service, the ministration of maid servants and hosts of friends, and repairs with her little brood to a rude cottage in an obscure section of the old town, confronted on the opposite side of the narrow street by the ancient graveyard, gloomy with its weeping willows, funereal cypresses, and moss-covered cedars, and flanked on either side by dwellings tenanted by persons the like of whom she had never known as associates, and who, on occasions, would publicly proclaim in clarion tones, "It makes no difference how high the eagle flies in the air. He's got to come down to get his support," as the immortal bard puts it. Oh, what a falling off my countrymen was there. End of chapter 1. Chapter 2 of Fact Stranger Than Fiction by John Patterson Green. Childhood Days. Is the road dreary? Patience yet. Rest will be sweeter if thou art aweary. Then bide a wee and in a fret. In commencing the first chapter, I stated humorously that I was born with a silver spoon in my mouth and rocked in the cradle of luxury, a mahogany cradle, to be explicit. But now all is changed, save that mother still retains a few pieces of the furniture and broken sets of silverware rescued from the flames, grim reminders of the fact that the besom of destruction had passed by and the merciless hand of fate was weighing heavily upon us. In that sad predicament, some of her friends wondered that she, being still in comparative youth and pleasing to look upon, did not accept several offers of marriage made to her, especially since her only means of existence for herself and three fatherless children was the use of the needle, which at that time and place was a source of very small remuneration. Her curt answer was that she would not place her children under any stepfather, to be treated in accordance with his whim or mood. My domestic environment was, apparently, all that could have been wished for a boy, far better than that of Abraham Lincoln, Frederick Douglass, or Booker T. Washington, at 5 years of age, for my food, though scant at times, was sufficient to sustain life at least. I had a feather bed still to sleep upon in cold weather, and mother, by extraordinary efforts, managed to preserve for me a Sunday suit of clothes. In addition to the support which we derived from the industrious use of the needle by our mother, we had in our garden, which was intelligently cultivated, a source of much assistance. In addition to a few plum trees and a large fig tree, all of which yielded abundantly in season, we raised fair crops of sweet corn, collards, and the medical roots and herbs which a century ago could be found in every well-regulated truck garden. Southern people and those native to the soil will recognize in the term collard a plant greatly resembling the cabbage down to the time when the cabbage heads. The collard is of a greener tint than the cabbage and never heads save to the size of a small orange in the center. When the frosts come, the leaves of the collards are streaked white and wind boiled in a big iron pot hung on trammels placed in the big fireplace with a piece of bacon, pork, or corned beef. Together with the well-known corn dodgers, they furnish the dish de resistance placed before a half-famished boy. I can't see at this writing what on earth would have become of us had we not been in possession of that little garden and a few chickens which furnished us with an occasional egg to vary the monotony of our diet. In order to procure a piece of fresh beef or a pound of liver, it was necessary to arise with the lark and hie us to the market house, which with the courthouse stood at the junction of the two principal streets and formed an imposing group. Let it not be imagined, however, that our dear mother was in any sense remiss or lax in providing for the future, for denying herself fine clothing and all the adornments of the body, so much coveted by many women, she dedicated her whole life to the support and partial education of her children. During the summer season she would save it as best she could, a dollar now and then for the purpose of buying a pig for the remainder of the year, and then when the weather was sufficiently cold she would purchase on the market one of the weight of 100 or 150 pounds and impose on this writer the task of wheeling it home. I have a very pleasant remembrance in this connection of a friendly, generous act performed in my behalf by a noble white lady during the winter of 1855-6, which goes far to prove that neither true gentlehood nor true womanhood is always to be found in the palace, nor must we search for them beneath robes and furred gowns. Now listen, Miss Arette Ellis, a maiden lady of culture and refinement, was the matron of the Griffin Academy, an institution founded for the nurture and education of poor white girls in that section of North Carolina. She was an Episcopalian by religious faith and attended Christ Episcopal Church at the head of her group every Sunday morning. She had known my father all her life, and she had seen me and my elder sister in our pew invariably every Sunday morning. On the occasion I am now referring to, I was wheeling in a wheelbarrow a dressed pig weighing about 150 pounds. I was 10 years of age and weighed exactly 50 pounds. Placing a 50-pound weight on one side of the old market scales, I would then stand upon the other side, and they would equally balance. As the slang phrase of the present day would have it, he was 50-50. The day to which I have referred was one of the coldest I've ever seen or felt, and I was minus an overcoat. I'd stopped at about half the distance to my destination to rest my muscles and recover my breath when along came Miss Arette Ellis, nicely and warmly clad, carrying in her hands a few parcels which she had just purchased from one of the dry goods stores where she had been shopping. Slackening her gait, she beamed upon me, a countenance full of sympathy and compassion. "Poor little fellow," she exclaimed, "aren't you very cold?" "Yes, ma'am," I answered. "Well, take my parcels and let me help you," was her rejoinder. Suiting the action to the word, she handed me the things, seized the handles of the wheelbarrow, and trundled it along the public street almost to my mother's door. Here was in very fact an angel in disguise. Her name was Arete, a Greek word which in the original Greek signifies talent, skill, fitness, courage, courage, etc., and surely on this occasion she proved that she was worthy of the name. Miss Ellis has long since been gathered into the bosom of her lord and master, whom she loved and served. It has been 65 years since this unselfish deed was done unto one of the least of these. But her face and form and kindly act lives and blooms perennially in my mind and heart, never to be forgotten, and whether there be erected monument or tablet in commemoration of her useful, virtuous, and noble life, I know not, but here and now I pour out to her all the gratitude and esteem of an appreciative heart, hoping that a knowledge of her goodness may stimulate others to go and do likewise. Returning to mother and her struggles, sometimes the bacon would be exhausted before the next pig would be purchased. At other times work would be scarce and the purse would be almost depleted. On such occasions the strictest economy would be required. Once in a while we would put some cornmeal into a bowl, sprinkle some salt in and upon it, pour in some hot water, and stir it thoroughly. After that we would place it on the griddle with live coals under it. When it browned on one side, we would turn it over and brown it on the other side. Then we would divide it into four equal parts, of which each one was given a portion to eat or let alone as the humor moved us. Judge John R. Donald, the widower of the late daughter of the former governor, Richard Dobbs Spite, of whom I have spoken, had a mansion about half a mile distant from the humble abode of my mother. Here were servants galore and food in abundance. Several of the servants were related by blood to my deceased father, and they sympathized with us in our forlorn condition. One of the poor slave women, for whom father had done a kindness, could not endure the thought of my elder sister doing the family washing, and be it said to her everlasting honor that she came to mother by night and begged permission to do the washing rather than that my sister should do it. Mother, in her stern, positive way, said, "No, Sarah has got to work for her living, and she may as well be learning now as later on." That ended the matter, and for years after that, while mother sewed, sister in her teens assisted and did the washing. Amongst Judge Donald's maid servants were two, one whom we denominated Little Auntie and another known as Aunt Hannah. Each was domiciled on the premises in adjoining rooms of an outhouse. Little Auntie was a cousin of my father, and quite reasonably regretted the great misfortune which had befallen us, and in her poor way she told mother to send me around there in the night time, and she would give me some milk to carry home, and such other little articles of food as remained over from the table of the great house. Of course we eagerly grasped at this opportunity of satisfying the cravings of hunger, and it became my duty to go to Judge Donald's every night and fetch home the bounty dispensed to us. This was at times a source of much assistance to us, and we made the most of it. Indeed, so jubilant was I over the trend of affairs that I was wont to exclaim in a superlative glee, "That woman that you call Little Auntie has a plenty. That woman you call Aunt Hannah has a plenty." And so these poor slave women, grateful for kindnesses which our big-hearted daddy had bestowed on them in the day of his abundance, found now their opportunity of repaying, almost in kind, what their true hearts had always been grateful for. In those days I was little more than 7 years of age, and frequently the streets through which I wended my way to Judge Donald's were as dark as Egypt. However, I quailed not, and when I could not see the route, I tried to feel it as best I could. Sometimes Aunt Hannah would sigh and say, "Ah, ere, Johnny, I haven't got nothing for ye tonight." On such occasions, returning home empty-handed, mother would say, "Well, go to bed and go to sleep, and you will forget your hunger." This I did on more than one occasion. We had our bright days, though, for on Christmas mother always secured a little turkey, and during the summer season we more than once enjoyed a luscious watermelon. As soon as I was strong enough to use a wood saw, I was given charge of sawing and splitting the firewood. A cord of hickory, oak, or ash wood would be thrown over our fence. After that, the trouble began. However, as I look back to those days and the benefit which I derived from my contact with those wood piles in the way of developing muscles and general physique, I am persuaded that the criminal branches of our courts would have less to do had every boy a woodpile and bucksaw in his backyard over which he could preside with honor and profit. This recalls the fact, which I am very proud of, that in the winter of 1858, when I was 13 years of age and weighed just 60 pounds, I raised the money to buy me a pair of skates by sawing and splitting and piling up 3 cords of wood. 2 cords I sawed into 3 pieces, and 1 cord I sawed into 2 pieces. It required much walking around the streets of Cleveland in order to find the wood, and I regret to relate it, after buying the skates, I used them only a few times before I was seized with pneumonia, and sold them for about one-half their purchase price. What limited skating I tried to do was without pleasure, for I wore shoes while the other boys wore boots. My shoes were too low for the proper strapping of the skates on, and my ankles would ever and anon turn over and cause me to fall. Another task which I had imposed upon me while I was yet a little boy in New Bern was that of turning the grindstone for Uncle Balaam Jones, a cooper, who would recompense me by supplying some portion of our firewood. Every Saturday afternoon I would go to Flanner's cooper shop, about half a mile distant from our home, to perform this function. I was too light and weak for the work, but mother permitted us to eat no idle bread. At times when Uncle Balaam would bear down with considerable weight, the grindstone would cease revolving. Then he would let up for a few moments and allow me to rest a little before proceeding again, and when finally the adze, the broad axe, the drawing knives, the chisels, etc., etc., were properly sharpened, I was well nigh exhausted, for be it remembered that I was conditioned like Hungry Jake in the minstrel show. The interlocutor said to him, "Brace up." Jake answered, "How can I brace up when I ain't got nothing to brace up on?" Many times I went to perform the task before I had dined, for mother was loath to lay her work down before she had accomplished a given task. The grinding being completed, then came my recompense. Uncle Balaam would select some defective ash heading, split them to convenient sizes, and fill my deep tray, which I had carried there for the purpose. After this, he would assist me in placing the burden on my head. I had no little four-wheeled wagon to draw it home in. Then I would start for home, half a mile distant. In the course of 4 or 5 minutes, the pressure upon the top of my 10-11-year-old cranium would cause my eyes to feel that they were beginning to bulge out, and my neck would pain me severely. In such an emergency, I would sidle up to the nearest fence and ease one end of my tray onto the top of it. Having rested a while, I would proceed on my course, repeating the act from time to time until I reached my home. On the route leading from the cooper shop to my home resided a family by the name of Bragg, father, mother, and some 7 sons and daughters. The father was a tailor by trade, carrying work to his home and performing it there with the assistance of his good wife and other members of his family. 2 of the boys, Cicero and Edwin, both of whom resembled white boys, seemed to have it in for me, and since there was no other route I could take in returning to my home from the cooper's shop, I was compelled to pass the residence of the Braggs, where these 2 boys, switches in hand, invariably waited me. Both were my superiors in age and size, and there was no alternative for me but to grin and bear the whipping which they administered to me as I quickened my pace with bulging eyes and aching neck. The complaints of my mother had little effect in stopping their brutal sport, for it would ever and anon recur. The irony and cruelty of this torture which they imposed on me was all the more conspicuous from the fact that my dear deceased father had, to a greater degree than anyone else in the world, been instrumental in securing Mrs. Bragg's freedom from slavery, even advancing some portion of the purchase price which had not been returned to him at the time of his death. Here is one sequel to what I have just recited. About 20 years after the occurrences between the 2 Bragg boys and me, Edwin and I were both residing in the city of Cleveland, Ohio, my present home. I was a lawyer and justice of the peace of the township of Cleveland, while Edwin was a barber. Edwin committed a larceny and was indicted for felony. He was without means, and I defended him gratis. I put forth every effort at my command to save him from the penitentiary, but all to no purpose. He was convicted of grand larceny and sentenced to serve a term in the state prison. In sentencing him to the penitentiary, the aged and learned Judge Foote complimented me on the energy and interest which I had evinced in defending the young man. I told the judge that he was the son of one of my deceased father's friends and the playmate of my childhood, whereupon the judge expressed great surprise and animadverted on the fact that he had fallen so low while I had followed another course. Later on in life his form crossed my vision. After that he was swallowed up in the human whirl and was lost to me entirely. On one occasion, while I was turning the grindstone for Uncle Balaam, an incident occurred which to my dying day will haunt my memory. Mr. Hancock, the town sergeant, came into the cooper's shop and exclaimed, "I want one of your men to make me a paddle." The men, one and all, knowing the purpose of torture that the paddle would be put to, stoutly refused to make it. This they could do with safety at that time, for they were slaves and knew that their masters would uphold and protect them in the refusal. It is not so in the South now. "Well," said the official, "give me a drawing knife and a brace and bit, and I will make it myself." He was as good as his word, for in a jiffy he had the instrument made and bored full of holes. He then took his departure, carrying the paddle with him. I followed him at a distance, for I was curious to learn the sequel. From my coign of vantage I saw him go to a remote spot up the shore of the Neuse River, which coursed near the location of the cooper's shop, and stop under a cypress tree which reared its head in the midst of the pure white sand. There stood a group of white men with a young negro in their midst awaiting him. As the sergeant busied himself in removing a portion of the unfortunate negro's clothing, tying his hands behind him and partially swinging him to one of the lower limbs of the tree by a rope attached to his wrists behind, I improved the opportunity in securing a position from which I could see every movement of the posse and hear the exclamations and groans of the tortured victim. Tortured, yes, tortured, for if it be not obvious to the most casual observer that a human being suspended by a rope attached to his wrists bound behind him must suffer excruciating pain, then let him try it for 1 minute as an experiment. By reason of the peculiar posture of the victim's body, the blows with the perforated paddle were administered with the utmost facility and with much force, which first blistered and then wounded the body, as I afterwards ascertained by going to the spot and viewing the sand, which at first white was now crimson with the blood of the poor slave, helpless in the hands of his tormentors. Oh, how earnestly I did plead with my dear mother on my return home to follow in the tracks of the Martins, the Hancocks, and the Stanleys, all of whom had recently left their native heath and gone in quest of a modicum of liberty into the great free north, east, and west. However, the time was not yet ripe for this important undertaking, and we must needs bide our time. The reason assigned for torturing this slave man was that he and another had conspired to blow up the dwelling house of a prominent citizen of the town. The victim of the torture had confessed to placing, like another Guy Fawkes, a keg of gunpowder under the residence and laying a train for its explosion to it, but no threats or tortures could force him to incriminate anyone else. When the resounding blows of the instrument would cause more blood to flow from the wound, he would exclaim, "O Lord, nobody but me and Jeff." But who Jeff was, if in very truth Jeff existed, no one could find out. Here perhaps is the place to give some account of the administration of justice in the old North State at that time in the history of our country. In the old courthouse, which was located in the heart of the business section of the town, was construed and to some extent applied a modified form of the English common law, as it existed before the days of Peel and his coadjutors, who pulled many of the fangs out of it. The courthouse had been there from that time whereof the memory of man ran not to the contrary, and with all modesty it resembled quite closely the old courthouse which we found standing in the southwest section of our public square on our arrival in 1857. Within this North Carolina courthouse, all the business of Craven County was transacted, even to the casting of ballots for all officials from president down to the least elective office. To this temple of justice trudged or stalked the grave and potent member of the bar and the honorable judges, sometimes carrying a green bag containing a volume of legal lore, at other times followed by a dark-hued slave carrying the same. The court being duly opened in a formal way by the sheriff of the county, who generally bearing not the fasces but a rod or pole of authority, would proceed to execute the preliminary orders of the court. Sometimes the court would say, "Sheriff, call Millie White." Then that august official would raise a window, or if in the summertime stick his head out of a window, and in stentorian tones call, "Millie White, Millie White, Millie White, oh yes, oh yes, oh yes, come into court, come into court," etc. Another name which comes down to me through the 70 years since I heard it is that of Irish Jimmy, Irish Jimmy, Irish Jimmy, oh yes, oh yes, oh yes, come into court, etc. The oh yes, is a corruption of the old Norman French, oh yes, hear ye, which for centuries prevailed in English courts of common law after the conquest. It was my fortune or misfortune to be in the court-room one morning when condign punishment was meted out to a person, white, who had been convicted of manslaughter. The sentence was that the prisoner should be branded in his right hand with a hot iron bearing the letters MS, signifying manslaughter, the iron not to be removed until the prisoner should exclaim 3 times, "God save the state, God save the state, God save the state." I watched almost breathlessly the sheriff bind the right hand of the convict securely to a small column, which was one of the supports of the ceiling of the courtroom. Then he drew from the stove, which furnished warmth to the room, a branding iron, which was quite hot. Without delay or more ado, the official pressed the hot iron against the thick portion of the prisoner's hand. There was a sizzling sound. Smoke curled up into the air, and there was a smell of burning flesh, while the convict exclaimed in rapid succession three times, "God save the state! God save the state! God save the state!" Immediately the iron was withdrawn, and I departed in haste to disclose to my mother and sisters the scene which I had witnessed. It was not an uncommon sight to witness in passing the jail yard a man standing in the stocks with his wrists and head fastened in the holes of the same. It was fortunate for the men who were punished in the stocks that they were within the jail yard, which had a fence around it, for the historians of England tell us that in times not so very remote, convicts in the stocks in the City of London were entirely at the mercy of heartless mobs, who would often stone them and sometimes pelt them with rotten vegetables, overripe eggs, and decaying cats. To such an extent was this persecution carried that frequently the victim lost his life. All persons convicted of capital offences were executed upon gallows, which was erected, when needed, in an old neglected field not so very remote from our residence. I saw a white man, John Tillman by name, hail through the street in which our residence was located in a tumbrel or cart, which was preceded and followed by an armed guard and hosts of curious people. Afterwards, standing at a respectful distance from the gallows, I witnessed the black cap drawn down over his face and his body swung into eternity. The reader will readily infer from what I have already written that there was not much going on in that old town, on land or on water, in those days which I did not see. If there was to be a sale or hiring of slaves on the auction block, I was near at hand to note every word, cry, or movement. If any one was to be lashed at the whipping post, there was this writer to behold it. At home frequently I would meet a warm reception on my return, after having neglected some domestic duty in order to keep tab on the varied county and municipal affairs. Mother was at times quite severe in her treatment of me, and I have always entertained the opinion that from her lack of proper educational facilities she was not keen to discover temperamental differences and to differentiate in the treatment of persons. My mother was as cold and sang-froid of temperament as any Scotchman of the Highlands, and as a matter of fact she could not or did not discover that I was a mere little bony bundle of nerves, that, like my dear deceased father, I had to do or die. To have kept either of us still would have entailed upon us St. Vitus' dance or epileptic fits. All the boys of the town knew me, white and black. The white boys scorned me because I was not white, and the black boys despised me because I was not entirely black. They would pick quarrels with me, and I would, with either my fists or weapons, defend myself. I had no big brother or other person to take my part, and it devolved upon me to hoe my own row, which I may add in all truth I proceeded to do to the best of my ability. On one occasion a crowd of white boys chased me like a pack of hounds baying at a stag. They did not give up until they had seen me enter my mother's door in safety. On another occasion, that same Millie White, a colored woman of the town, whose name was called by the count Court Crier, assaulted me in the Academy Green, on my way homeward carrying a tray of sweet potatoes on my head, and it was not the first time. And happening to have a small knife open in one of my hands, I defended myself by letting her have it in one of her hips. It was her last assault on me. That was the nearest I ever came to being arrested, for she made a complaint against me to the authorities, who sent the same town sergeant he was our police force to investigate. He, on hearing the statements of my mother and myself, said the woman had received no more than she deserved and dropped the matter. The colored women of the lower class seemed to be piqued at my mother because she had never associated with them, and even in her changed and humble condition she carried her head high and scorned the association of all white or black who were not congenial or fit. One of these colored Amazons, who wished to make me the scapegoat of once upon a time when I was about 9 years old of age, got me cornered in such a way that no choice was left to me except to fight or be soundly beaten. In that emergency I picked up a stone, closed my eyes, and like another Macduff laid on. When my antagonist called a halt and ceased her struggle, I opened my eyes to find her pretty thoroughly covered with blood. This struggle against great odds on my part was viewed by an old friend of my deceased father, who declared that I was the worst boy in town, a declaration which made a lasting impression on my mind and is still ringing in my ears. I've often debated the question, did Mr. Green state a fact, or was he ignorant of conditions and biased for some unknown reason against me? What are the characteristics of a bad boy? I assert, after an experience of 50 years as an attorney at law, much of the time spent in defending persons indicted for and charged with felonies and misdemeanors, persons ranging in age from 10 years of age to old age, that to be a bad boy or a bad man, one must have an evil, malicious heart, and his deeds must be the offsprings of such a heart. But if, on the contrary, a person's heart is free from envy, hatred, malice, and all uncharitableness, he is not in any sense bad. I've known boys to lie, cheat, and steal, to delight in causing pain and suffering to both man and beast. I knew a boy once who derived pleasure from seeing a chicken suffer after he had cut off its feet. I saw a young southern blood on one occasion raise his gun and shoot to death a beautiful spaniel dog, his good friend, because he failed to obey his command and come to him directly.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.